Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Chris Stiles, and I have the great privilege of being Dean of UNSW Business School. I'd like to warmly welcome you all here this evening, alumni, friends and guests to this evening's Meet the CEO event. And a very special welcome to the Chancellor of UNSW, David Gonski, our alumni leaders and members of our Business Advisory Council who are here this evening. Welcome. I'd like to acknowledge the Gadigal people as the traditional custodians of the lands where we are situated as part of the Eora Nation. We acknowledge all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander elders, past and present, and their communities who've shared and practised their teachings over thousands of years, including business practices. And we recognise Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's ongoing leadership and contributions, including to business education and industry. This is the second Meet the CEO of three for 2016, and we're very pleased to have as our guest Christine Holgate, CEO of Blackmores, who will be interviewed by our very own Business Advisory Council member, Mark Scott, who also has a day job in addition to doing our interviewing and, of course, is Secretary of the New South Wales Education Department and is therefore our boss. So a very warm welcome to you, Mark, and it's all going fine. This is our 13th year of Meet the CEO, and as I said, this is the second, but it's the second we're holding in Sydney. We're having a third Meet the CEO, which will be held in Melbourne on November the 8th with ANZ CEO Shane Elliott. And we're really delighted to bring to you all the people of the calibre of Christine and Shane to our alumni and our supporters. And we're also very, very pleased to take this on the road to other parts of Australia, and indeed we have done one in Hong Kong as well. So we do really want to take this and share this with all our alumni. And speaking of Melbourne, you will be hearing more about Christine's extraordinary career in a moment. She, of course, has been incredibly successful and commands huge respect amongst the business community. Indeed, she has almost had the perfect career. When I say almost, I did note from her LinkedIn profile that she is director of the Collingwood Football Club. Now, if we were in Melbourne, she reminded me, most three-quarters of the room might have walked out by now, but as a card-carrying, rather devastated Sydney Swans fan at the moment, even I welcome you. And it's a pity that Collingwood gets your great talents, but I think it's great for them and great for the AFL. So you are most welcome. We, of course, again, are streaming this interview live tonight through YouTube and Facebook, inviting our alumni throughout Australia and the world to watch. Now, if you are a tweeter, I encourage you to get involved in the conversation by following us on Twitter. Now, I usually read this out, and it's really difficult, but someone told me it's actually on the screen. So it's on the screen, and no one can read it, so there we are. So I'll read it out. At UNSW Business, and the hashtags, hashtag Meet the CEO, or one word, and hashtag UNSW. It will, I hope, come up at some point. There we are. See, it works, doesn't it? And importantly, of course, you can tweet your questions throughout the interview, and when we get to the Q&A session, Mark will address some of the questions that have come through Twitter, and then take questions from the floor as well. So now, can I please ask you to keep your hopefully not exploding handsets on if you want to tweet, but the phone part off, throughout the interview. Okay, it's now my pleasure to welcome the Chancellor of UNSW, David Gonski, to give a more formal welcome to Christine and Mark. Thank you, David.
Ladies and gentlemen, if the Dean looks quite worried at times, it's because he and I have this discourse that we mustn't use the same lines twice. And I'm very pleased and proud to be able to welcome you on behalf of the entire University of New South Wales family to this wonderful event. And there are two major things that he didn't say that I want to say before giving some detail on Christine. The first was that he didn't mention our 2025 strategy, which apparently once mentioned before you go to sleep, after you've had breakfast and so on. And the key to the University of New South Wales' great strategy is that we're looking internationally, that we're looking for international partnerships, that we're looking to tap the international education market and indeed to be involved in the strategic issues of international. Why is that relevant to tonight? Well, anybody who knows about Christine Holgate knows that she has made Blackmores international, that she thinks on an international basis, and I, for one, will be listening very carefully just to check our 2025 program is on the right plane. The second thing that the Dean didn't mention was he said there was only one blemish in her CV, something about football clubs in Melbourne. But there's a much more important blemish that Christine has. She has an incredible array of degrees, 3 graduate certificates, an MBA, and not one of them from the University of New South Wales. Having the crack interviewer that I'll also introduce in a minute, I'm sure he'll find out why. Tonight's guest is a real star. She is absolutely wonderful. I've enjoyed the discussions that I've been privileged to have over the years with her, and I know you'll enjoy tonight. She is, of course, the CEO of Blackmores, but that says very little compared to a 30-year history, diverse as it is, in international leadership in industries such as healthcare, media, telecommunications, and finance. But if that's not enough, she's also done things in the community. She is, as you probably know, the inaugural chair of the board of the Australia-ASEAN Council. She's been involved, as we heard, in football clubs. She's been a non-executive director of the 10 Network, having retired there only a year ago. But in the last 8 years, as CEO of Blackmores, she's made an incredible effect. You only have to look at the share price to know what a wonderful job she's done. Tonight we decided she deserved an A-grade interviewer, and we've got Mark Scott, as you've heard. And we chose him not just because he is our boss as Secretary of the Department of Education, and not because he's a member of the UNSW Business School Advisory Council, because there's about 50 of them and they all want to interview for the CEO, meet the CEO, but we asked him because he has a talent, a real talent of interview. An ability to be nice on the surface, incisive a bit below, and you'll see the rest of his wonderful things. He was basically given an honorary doctorate this year by the university because of his success in the outside world, but also his generosity to our university in the time and advice he gives. Well, you didn't come to hear from me. I've now covered what Chris generously allowed me to do, and I now call upon Christine and Mark to come to the stage.
I've just stole your water.
That's Crotter. Well, welcome to Meet the CEO, Christine. It's a happy and wonderful crowd, and the grand tradition here is that I ask softball, easy questions to just warm you up and get your eye in, and then in about half an hour or so, we'll let the room loose with all those sharp, intelligent University of New South Wales graduates to ask the really tough questions. Before we get into it, I just wanted to tell you the story of a conversation I had with my mother-in-law a little while ago, one of those reflective conversations that families can have, and I asked her if she had any regrets in her life, and like a flash, she came back and said her greatest regret, not buying more Blackmores shares. which is pretty good. If you get to 80 and that's your greatest regret, I thought that was good, and I'm glad she was happy. But we'll talk about Blackmores in a minute, because it is such a remarkable story, your stewardship at Blackmores. But I'm interested in going back to your growing up in England and where you decided that business was going to be your thing and that you wanted to pursue a career as a businesswoman.
I don't know if I really conscientiously decided that. Look, I remember as a small child, my parents didn't believe in pocket money, so you had to earn it. So I always kind of, I used to keep a packet of cards in my knickers. And so to earn money, I'd wait for somebody to turn up at the farm, and then I'd say, oh, do you want to pay 21? And then I'd try and take money off them. So
parents already making it, no pocket money, encourage your children to gamble if you want them to pursue
a career. I was quite good at maths. So one of our finance team, Adrian's here tonight, and I think I'm always the bane of the finance team's life because I can add up, and that's quite good for doing pontoon. So I'm not sure that I consciously did, but when I was in London, I arrived in London and didn't have a job and didn't know anyone, and that's a bit of a story in itself, but I met this old lady, and she sort of saved me, and after a few months as working as a waitress, she said, you've got to go to business school, she was a cleaner at the BBC, she said, you cannot be a waitress, I'm not going to let what happened to you happen to me, because I had no choice. Mm. So somebody from the church she went to was actually the dean of the business school. So she basically nobbled him and said, you're taking her. And that's how I went to study business studies. So I'm sorry that's not some perfect answer, everybody. But you have to know at the time.
I think it's the most original answer we've had in 13 years and a great start to a spectacular career. And if we look at your career before you came to Australia, one of the things that's really interesting, and I think the Chancellor referred to it early, is it's a very varied career, really. It's a number of different companies, a number of different industries, and a number of different roles in those industries. I mean, we've had people here at Meet the CEO, and John Borghetti had worked in aviation for his entire career, or Ian Narev had spent a long time in consultancy before he went to the Commonwealth Bank. But you were in marketing, in line management, in investor relations. Was that a plan? Was that a strategy? Or is that how it worked through? And how has that impacted on how you do the role now?
Well, I think even if you're not a CEO in any role that you do, and you've got the privilege of leading a team, being able to relate to the people in any part of that food chain, I think is quite important. Yeah. I spent this afternoon in the warehouse and talking to one of the guys, and actually his one summer job, I was a welder. And he couldn't believe that I did spot welding, but I did. And I think it's really... Do you know what? I think it's fantastic if you can relate to everybody in your team at some part. Clearly, you don't do every job, but if you can have an understanding of those roles, I think it's really important. And if you just go straight up, which you don't always do that because, you know, you just go up in a discipline. But I'm a very loyal person, and I've never worked for a competitor. So I've had to change industry. And things actually have come along. Look, I worked at Cable & Wireless for 12 years, and they sent me all around the world and had this incredible opportunity. And then I was posted to Hong Kong, and something happened, and I made a personal decision. I wanted to be back in London for a while. And on the plane, realizing I was having to give up my dream job in Hong Kong Telecom, just by chance. You know how you're sitting on a plane and someone says to you, oh, how are you? And normally you go, fine. Don't you, you know, or you put the TV on. I said, oh, I'm terrible. You won't believe what's happened. And I didn't know this. But the guy just happened to be the chairman of JP Morgan for Europe. Anyway, I got off the plane and he said, here's my card, by the way. I'm Walter Goubert. I am the chairman of JP. And at the time, JP Morgan was before Chase. So I don't know if anyone's in JP Morgan here, but they used to say before the C word. And it's where 70% of the EVA of the bank was. Mm. And they lent Cable & Wireless all their debt. And we had a lot of debt at the time. So he phoned up the Cable & Wireless chairman the following day and said, you've got this person. I sat next to her. I wanted to come and work for me. So sometimes things happen, not because you plan them so much, but maybe just because you're open and, you know, someone can see something. I do think sometimes we underestimate the importance of giving people feedback and then the influence that feedback can have on that person. So David's very good at this. I think any woman in the room with a career would say that David's one of the people that we all held up in the highest esteem. I'm not saying this because I told him earlier as well, by the way, and I tell him quite often. But, you know, it's really important that sometimes people... when you're going through a challenging time, give you a word of motivation or support or encouragement, because it kind of spurs you on to the next part.
You mentioned David there. You've talked about other mentors, David Thodey, when you came and worked for Telstra here. I think a lot of people in the room, particularly those at the beginning of their careers, think about, you know, do I need a mentor? How do I get a mentor? What advice do you give to people about identifying the right person to be an influence in their careers?
Well, I don't think it should be your boss is my first thing, because often people at work come to me and say, will you be my mentor? And I say, look, I can, but really I'm only going to ask you to do what I want you to do, not necessarily it's in your best interest. Mm. So I think that's the first thing you've got to realize. I think, you can have many mentors, and they can be people that you see each week, or they might be people that you only see twice a year. I think you've got to understand, what do you want a mentor to do? Mm. We own most of our own problems. We are the answer to most of our own problems. We are so often the person who holds us back the most. Sometimes we just need someone like David to say, get on with it. And then we'll get on with it. He doesn't have to see me again for another year. So I think I really believe in mentors, because I believe in that shared knowledge and learning. But I think you've got to be careful. He's not going to answer your career.
Mm. You had a spectacular career with Cable and Wireless and JP Morgan and others, but there were challenging moments. You were involved with Energys, which was a FTSE 100 firm. It had a market cap of 10 million pounds, but it was a boom company, but it ended up in administration, and you'd only been with them for a short time before it hit the wall, really. What did you take out of that experience, and how important is that experience as part of your career experience and life experience?
It was a £1 billion sterling market cap, and we were heralded as sort of the golden stock. I took away a few things. The first thing was I knew the chairman of the company very well, and he had targeted me to go and work there. And because I'd worked with him a lot previously, I probably didn't do my due diligence on their accounts the same as I would do normally. So even if someone comes bearing you gifts, be wary, because I should have looked at their to understand the cash flow of the business. And actually, my first day in the job, the CEO resigns. My first board meeting in the job, they said, oh, we want you to do a strategy review. And I remember having looked at the financial accounts and said, actually, I think we need to do a cash flow review. I don't think we're going to be able to pay the bond coupon. Mm. And we couldn't pay the bond coupon, and we went through a whole financial restructuring. Actually, I loved it. I don't know why. I think it was the one person in the company who loved that fighting to save the organization. What it taught me, though, there afterwards, is that so often when people report about people's accounts and things, they talk about profit. Actually, cash runs a company, nothing else. Cash, and cash is king, and that's the most important thing, and just that whole importance of cash in a business. When you're working for a company and the electricity doesn't switch on one Monday morning and you put your personal credit card on the line, this was a big company. This was a company with 2 billion sterling turnover. It wasn't a small one. We turned up at the office and the electric had been switched off. And I said, I've got an American Express. Apparently, they don't take a limit. And it was my personal one. And I remember Richard, who works with us now at Blackmore, saying, but you may never get the money back. I said, well, I won't pay American Express. Come on. And we paid the electric. And that was a fantastic moment, by the way. You're going to have the brilliant employee relations in the hardest times, because that's when you really know who your employees are. That's when they corral together, and that's when they come together. So it's not always a hard time, is not always the worst time.
So after that experience and all these terrific international experiences with great firms, you decide, as I understand it, that Australia, and you just get, not with a job lined up, you just fly out and meet a headhunter. That seems like a big, bold career gamble. Why did you decide to do that?
Well, the company that you were talking about, Energys, we went through a financial restructuring, and in the process of that, the bondholder, I don't know if anyone knows, is anyone a bondholder here? please, I hope you're not, because bondholders are the bastards of the corporate world. They are, aren't they, David? And so they're the ones who give you a hardest time when you don't pay the bills. But late one night, this guy from Linklaters phoned me and said, have you ever wanted to be CEO yourself? Come in and meet us. And I went, it was 10 o'clock at night, and he said, come back the next day and give us a business plan, but you have to be back by 9 in the morning. What would you do if you were CEO? You know, this was like a dream ticket. So I stayed up all night, I phoned people all night, woke everybody up. I went in and said, this is what my board would be, this is what we would do. And they said, right, we're going to back you. And they made a bid for the company. Anyway, banks have first call on the debt, and the bondholders had second, and the banks were a multitude of banks, and they created what is called a... I know this is a long story.
It's a good story, though. Keep going. We're listening to everything.
They created what they call an SPV, a special purpose vehicle, and they then bid against the bondholders, and they have the first call. So once they created that consortium, we were knocked out. So I didn't get my dream job. And a guy called Archie Norman, who's sort of a bit of a guru in the UK, who David probably knows, became chairman. And he said, don't go, stay, and we'll give you a job in the management team. But you're so close to the sun. And then the sun gets taken away from you. And I was like number four employee. And you know what? I realized I was the problem. I just turn up every day at work and think he's making the wrong decision. So I was taking my team out one night, and I was so frustrated. And I knew what I had to do is actually go and live at the other side of the world. So I couldn't interfere and couldn't be angry. And you know, I hate being disloyal, so I...
You pulled out a map.
And, you know, I'd been to Australia, and it was always sunny. And I moved here, and I swear to you, it rained for like 3 months.
So you arrived here, you spoke to a headhunter. How did you end up at Telstra then?
I did actually that the next day. Actually, the next day I called my mother and said, do you want to come to Australia tomorrow? And I phoned somebody called Rod Olson. Some of you may know him. He was the chairman here for some time for Optus. And I'd known him for Commonwealth. And he said, go to this headhunter. He was called John Powell. If anyone knows him, he now works at Talent 2. He worked at Corn Ferry, actually, at the time. And he said, Corn Ferry are the best headhunters in town. Contact them. So that Saturday, I wrote to this guy. And he called me on the Sunday and said, look, I'm a bit busy. While you come over, you can see this lady, Lynn. And I said, who's Lynn? And he said, oh, she's my assistant. So I can't see you. So he said, no, I'm busy. So I said, well, you mustn't be the person to help me then. Thank you. I don't want you to help me. I'll find another headhunter. I think he was so annoyed. He called me. You can ask John this. He called me back half an hour later and said, when do you land? I said, I land at 5:30 on Monday morning. He said, OK, come in and see me at 9 o'clock. So I did. And literally the next day, I met Ziggy and I met David Thodey. And before the end of the week, I was going to work for Telstra.
It's a brilliant career. It's a hard career to replicate, I think, if you're making notes. But it's a brilliant career.
Didn't always feel brilliant, by the way. And can I just tell you something? All those nice words those people said, I'm just one person and team. Like, it's not one person who delivers those results. Those results happen after many years of hard work of many people. So please do not think that some of the things that we've been able... We're on a journey. We're on a journey. We're nowhere near where we need to be.
So let's move to Blackmores. There's a great quote in a profile about you. It said, she's a passionate believer in the benefits of natural health supplements and a hard-nosed businesswoman. Can someone be one part earth mother and four parts an inspiring leader with a steely focus on lifting investment returns in the best traditions of hardcore capitalism? Do you buy that one part earth mother, four parts inspiring leader?
I should. Kerry works for me. I mean, maybe she'd be a better judge.
Inspiring leader.
That's the word. Why Blackmores? I mean, in a way, you work for these big corporations, and there is this, in a sense, quite idiosyncratic family business, strong consumer product. What was it about your conversations with Marcus Blackmore that made you think you stepping into that family business, in a sense, even though listed family business, was a great fit for you?
I didn't see it as a family business. You know, you get to crossroads in your life, and that's when you get to make a decision. And they're actually normally some of the darkest moments of your life, but they can be some of the most compelling. And my sister died, and she died of cancer. And I was very close to her. And it was a really, even now I'm emotional talking about it. In the journey, we were very, very close, and in the journey of Elizabeth, you know, when someone's dying that you love, you will do anything to save them. Anything. You will cut your hand off if it gives them 2 more weeks with their children. And so I'm a researcher, and I never give up. And so I just researched and researched, and there was all these Lance Armstrong said gojo berries saved him from cancer. And lots of other, I mean, maybe later on we found out different, but was what I wanted to hear at the time. So, look, it wasn't going to save her from cancer, but it was going to improve the quality of her life. And so my grandmother had been a herbalist, and I grew up in a farming community. And so I started to passionately research natural medicine and got my sister with a London homeopathic hospital. And it was about aiding her as she went through such torturous procedures. And so this kind of love came. I was asked to meet Marcus. I thought, I don't want to run a natural health company. You know, I want to go and live in China. And he didn't really want to meet me, by the way, and everybody, did he? And so we did meet, but I think within 30 minutes, you know, Marcus and I had a connection. And I don't mean that in a negative way. I think for me, I've always had something where I've always thought that maybe I should be doing a job where, you know, you're giving back to society. It's not about profit. It's about these other things, and you know, you contribute in a much more deep and meaningful way. And yet, I've got this side of me that I call it sort of free market socialism, that, you know, you create wealth and you give it away and help people live better lives. And I truly believe in that. And I thought, I could see with Blackmores, I could become the CEO of a public company. I could grow this company, and I could help this company help people have better lives. So all these different boxes were ticking. I didn't see the family small company before I took the job. You know, I saw the future.
Yeah. And would you say in your career and now in your work in Blackmores that an affinity with the product and an affinity with what it is you're selling is important to your motivation and effectiveness and how you approach the job still?
I think it's really important to most people that I meet that, you know, if you don't believe in what you're doing, how do you do it with any authenticity? And people will see through you really quickly. And I think what makes Blackmores unique is that we have a really, really strong culture. What we stand for as a company, it's actually the same as what Marcus's father wrote 85 years ago. That actually hasn't changed. Who we are and what we do to achieve that has changed. And I think it creates this armor around us that, and it unites us so we can do all sorts of different jobs. We can actually argue, but we have this glue. And, you know, people like Kerry and I and Adrian, wherever Adrian is, you know, we often said they're not a Blackmores person. And we can interview them and they can be the best possible person in their skill, but they won't work with us because they just don't have that thing. They're not passionate. Then, you know, and if you have people full of highly skilled people who aren't passionate, forget it. The smartest people don't make the best performers. Sorry, in a university to say that.
You said that in that discussion with Marcus Blackmore, you said, look, something like you didn't want to go run a natural health company. You wanted to go and live in China, work in China. Of course, that's where the Blackmores Road ended up. But in 2008, when you started the job and you looked at the opportunities and the growth strategy, was China fixed in your mind from the beginning? If you look back now and look at the China expansion and the China success, was that always part of the plan, or did that evolve over time?
No, I think, yes, absolutely it was, quite frankly. Look, I'd studied Chinese for 3 years when I was living in London at SOAS. I'm a great believer that China, anyone who goes to Beijing, I just love it. You know, just to feel the power of that square and those people. It's a land full of opportunity, and it was quite visible for a long time. It's going to be the biggest economy in the world. But I, you know, as a small child, my father was an entrepreneur, and he became friends with a man in Liverpool, and this man lent some money of him, and he was a Chinese man, and he then lost it at Mahjong. And my father was a farmer. We grew up in a village like Midsummer's Murder, so it was a bit unusual. And then my dad came home and said, "Whoops, I've lent some money, Beryl." That was my mum. "And we're not going to see it again." And he said, "But we've got, you know, a share in a Chinese restaurant in Liverpool." So we used to spend Sunday nights as a whole family going to this Chinese restaurant. So I fell in love with China. I fell in love with this. So I'm being completely honest with you. I fell in love with this ceremony of eating, you know, and how beautiful the women are. And they wear these beautiful outfits and this chopstick thing and these beautiful bowls, you know. When you grow up on a farm, everything's earthenware. It's sort of, and I don't eat meat, and it's always meat. So I just fell in love with that first Asian influence. And of course, then, as I became older and I worked in Hong Kong, you can just see this huge passion for natural health they had. So then I get to Blackmores. Before I got to Blackmores, my probably second line to Marcus was, how come you're not making any money in Asia? This is the home of natural health. Mm. So I was pretty determined we were going to go to China, but I just couldn't do it day one because we had a number of countries already which were grossly underperforming. And, you know, you have to turn those businesses around. There was no one really believed. Only Marcus, day one, supported me doing the Asia strategy.
I mean, the experience of many firms going to China for many years, it's a very challenging testing market, and far more have returned with strategy in tatters rather than strategy successful. Are there things you look at in your business intelligence about how to successfully crack that market that were keys to your success?
Look, the first thing, I got kind of lucky, if I was honest, because I met when I was at Telstra the Austrade head of Asia, based here, and he'd done 16 years or something of a 23-year career in China. The guy spoke fluent Chinese, his wife was Taiwanese. And, you know, to do business in Asia, you have to really respect government. It's not like here where we sort of, someone becomes prime minister. But we, you know, we are a... forgive me, Mark, I know that's challenging, but, you know, there's... I do find that kind of interesting. Is whoever gets in power, doesn't matter what party or sex they are, we sort of knock them over immediately. But it's so different in Asia, and they have such a long-term view. And government is how things happen, so you have to respect how they work. And I could see I knew nothing about it, but he knew everything. And that's my top tip for tonight, by the way. DFAT and Austrade are this amazing resource that is in every single country, and they're here to help you, and they're free. So don't pay for consultants.
Present company excluded.
Go to Austria. and so that was the first thing. But I think the other thing was, and I think this is the next most important thing you must do, is make sure you have a strong chairman and aligned board. If you do not have a chairman who believes in your strategy, if he's managing you by KPIs, forget it before you start, because your KPIs are going to go wrong on a journey in Asia. Plenty of things to me have gone wrong. So, you know, you need a strong chairman and a strong board to back you for when you have those big dips, and we've had plenty. The other thing I think is have a strong local team. Do not employ expats, because when you employ a local person, that person, most people are most conscious about what their family think about them. You know, I'm most conscious what my mother thinks about me. And I reckon half of you in this room are too. Or it might be your wife, it might be your son, it might be your daughter, it could be your mother. When you employ a local person, they want to build a business their parents are proud of. If you can capture pride in someone's heart, then they will build you a strong business. They wake up in the morning and they think like the consumer. You cannot translate Chinese in Google Translate. The word Shay has 26 different meanings and it comes in 4 different tones. So I studied Chinese and I will not speak it to you except for Wo Wai Sheng Guo. For all the Chinese, I know what I'm saying. But, you know, you have to get local people. You know, and I think so often I go to not just China, any Asian country, and we've got an expat in charge of the business.
We're shortly going to go to questions, and the hashtag is Meet the CEO, so if you've got a question for Christine, fire that in right now. I mean, when China took off, it really so took off for Blackmores. Share price, stratospheric heights, big increase in profits, enormous publicity and attention for you, on all the lists of being the top CEO, most powerful people in the country. Share prices come back a bit since those heady days, but still, it's a remarkable performance. How do you keep everyone's feet on the ground when the rush must be so big about the boom? And the critics who are there saying, well, actually, the share price isn't over $200 now the way it was. This can't be kept up. How do you kind of steady the ship between the optimists and the pessimists who say it was just a boom?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. Look, my personal view is I do not see the reason why in the future Blackmores can't be $2 billion in turnover. We can't be the leaders in the world in our category. We have the best people. Now, it will not be all plain sailing. We've just gone to the market and told them the first quarter will be down. Every business that we've got other than Australia growing strong. So what's happening here in Australia? The Chinese daigos are buying differently. We have to just change our business, you know, and serve those people differently. And we have to re-engineer our business and we have to do it over again. We're doing it. And you know what? It will come out stronger. And sometimes when you have a problem, it shakes you. You know, it shakes the company. It's not a bad thing. When you grow so fast, cost comes in your business, you're growing, growing, growing. It gives you an opportunity. You know, it's not easy, but I've had lots of lessons that, you know, the things that don't taste nice can actually make you stronger. So I think for me, you know, we have to focus long term. Just even though I do quarterly reporting, which is very short term, we have to keep thinking long term and keep driving for those goals. So we're very lucky that we have Marcus, whose name's on the door. You know, he wants to leave a legacy behind him when he dies. He does not think about this quarter. Clearly, he wants me to tell him it will get better one day. But he is thinking of building something for the long term for this industry, and that is a really powerful combination. And for our staff, you know, we share our profits with our staff. With 10% of our profits, we give back to our staff, so absolutely everybody is aligned with the shareholders. Doesn't matter who you are. You can be, you know, the Filipino lady today on Pick Delight, or this young Scottish guy in the warehouse. Doesn't matter if you're them, you're me, or anybody. You get profit share days. So we all know them, don't we? 44 days last year, every member of staff at Blackmore's got. You know, isn't that amazing? We could treble our dividends. The shareholders got record payouts. You know, our shareholders have been with us for a long time. 70% of our shareholders have held our stock for more than 10 years. The share price goes to $100, $200. They're not the people selling it. These are the institutions. Our mums and dads, they take our products, they get our dividends, they live on our dividend check. We are serving that business. And you know, I cannot control the share price, but I can help influence the operations of the company. And I can help, like these two women on the front row who work at Blackmores, together we can build our profit share days. And if we do that, the shareholders are happy.
So just one last question from me before we go to the room. You're talking about a long-term vision, a long-term strategy, big global ambitions. They will take time. Next month, Hillary Clinton, God willing, will be elected President of the United States. And she will then shortly turn 70, right? Australia turns over CEOs quite quickly. CEOs are being appointed younger than ever before. The tenure of CEOs come shorter. You're already have served a longer time than the average CEO. But why wouldn't you go on for decades in this role? And how do you think about length of a career and tenure of a career? If it's going well and you have great ambition, you know, is this not the kind of thing that happy shareholders and happy staff would want you to do till you're Hillary Clinton's age?
Well, I have, you know, I have a slight problem, first of all, with the US elections. And
you're not alone there.
You know, and it's not just Donald. I really, you know, I'm disappointed that we're at this stage where they play such a major part of our world. And forgive me that we're going to be passing this to one or two people who are going to be 72. And I just feel like with all the incredible people in the US, that we're here with two people no one wants. You know, nobody wants, you know, the people, why has Donald come so far? Because they're voting against Hillary. You know, they're not voting for Donald, they're voting against Hillary. So, and I just think it's so disappointing. I love Bill Clinton, by the way, you know, I think he did such an incredible job. And I think Hillary did too, in many ways. But I don't think she's the right person to be president, but I certainly don't think Donald Trump is. And I think it's just so disappointing as a world citizen, here we are. So that's the first thing. So nothing to do with being 72. Somebody said to me the other day, a shareholder who said, well, you're not going to stay. You know, you're doing all these things. You're going to go off and do something else. You know, you're doing the same job from 8 years ago. I said, I'm not doing the same job. He said, Shishua, well, you're CEO of Blackmores. I said, no, see Dave Fenlon? This is my guy who runs Australia. Sitting next to me, he said, yeah, he's doing the job that I came in and did. Because when I came into Blackmores, you know, we were an Australian company. You know, we were 180 million and 80 million profit, and we made more than 100% of our profit in Australia. We're not that today. We're more than 700 million in turnover, and more than our revenues come from Asia than anywhere else. We've got a practitioner business, pharmaceuticals. We bought a Chinese herbal business recently, and we're going to go into Chinese herbal medicine. Do you know there's 4,500 registered Chinese traditional medicine practitioners in Australia? There are only 5,000 pharmacies. So think about that. Think about the influence this is having in our society. I'm not doing that Blackmores Australia job. Dave's doing that. So if you want to stay CEO and you love what you're doing, make sure you're growing your business and creating new businesses so you're not doing the same job.
Great answer. We have a few questions from Twitter, and one of the ones that's come through is talking about innovation at Blackmores. How does Blackmores innovate, and how are you using technology to advance Blackmores?
Yes, it's interesting. I just was at the CEDAR conference this week. I don't know if anyone else was here. But, you know, we seem to think that there's a lot of people at that conference seem to think that innovation meant technology. And I don't think it does. I think innovation is about doing something differently. Not always new, by the way, but differently. And I think anyone can innovate, and anyone can have that idea. You know, Kerry is sitting here at the front here, but we had a competition, you know, last year about we're a company doing quite well, so we're doing good. How could we be great? Jim Collins was coming to Australia, and if you tell me how you think we could be great, I will send you to meet Jim Collins. Long story how I got that, a bit of one of those stories, David. And you know, you should have seen the amazing ideas that came through from our staff. Just incredible ideas. The one, yours was very good, Kerry. She went to Jim Collins. But the one that really inspired me was a guy who was a casualer on my night shift. And he really taught me something. He was a refugee from Iran. His wife was from Iraq, and he was from Iran, and he married this lady, and then they ended up having to be a refugee. And he wrote me this answer, and he said, first of all, he went on and on about being the refugee and a casual, and you know, I'll get your answer. He said, I think you should do medicinal teas. And he wrote this whole answer about medicinal teas. And he had a master's degree in agricultural engineering, and he had studied medicinal medicine in teas. It was phenomenal. How amazing was this answer? And I phoned him up. I was actually sitting in the airport. His answer was late. It came in too late. I said, you're not going to win because you're too late. There's the rules. You know, if you don't get the rules, you can't win. The first thing in business, you have to learn. There's a deadline. But second is, I love your answer. And he says, oh, I don't have a job and I haven't got a home. It's going on and on. And I said, Mika, look, I've got to catch a plane. Just tell your wife you've got a job. Come and see me a week on Monday. And that week on Monday, I came to the office. He brought his whole family. And you know, am I allowed to tell this story? This is a lovely story. I'm sorry, I talk too much. Typical female. Do you know, one of the most beautiful things that have happened to me in my career was this journey with Miko. And so I told him, look, I've thought about it. I've got you a job. You're actually going to go and set that medicinal tea business up. And you're now going to work for Evan. You're off the casuals. He was earning $45,000, and we gave him a salary of $100,000 a year. And it's just a beautiful, so we checked out his qualifications and they were real, and he's making a fabulous contribution. But the real most beautiful thing was, in January, I got married, and I got back to work on the first day, and he said, can I come and see you? I've got a parcel for you, and I want my wife to come. They do kind of come with their family. So he came, and she carves wood. And she'd carved me out of a piece of wood, a most beautiful saying, I would rather die standing up than lie kneeling down. Isn't that beautiful? It made me cry. You know, this is a family who was a refugee, who came to Australia thinking they were coming to the Golden Land. They end up in shared accommodation, living in Western Sydney. Their amazing qualifications are not able to be used. And they're working as a casual and on night shift, and he thought he was lucky. You know, and then they write this. You know, in Australia, we have some of the most amazing people who can help us grow and develop our businesses, and they're here, and they're our immigrants. And I just wish more of us would, you know, bring our hearts closer to them and bring them in, because they can help us grow our business.
We're just going to turn up the lights now and see if there are questions from the floor. Just on the sentiment behind your last statement. You're quoted as saying corporate Australia in general doesn't speak out loudly or often enough on issues of national significance or on critical importance to business. What are the issues that you want to speak out about?
I've got a current one, okay? I share this. I often have ones. So I share this one because we are here in a university. I'm sitting next to David, and I said, David, how many are your students from Asia? And he said, it's not true what they say. You know, there are a lot of them are born here. You know, we have a lot of Asians, but they're born here. I said, oh, okay, David. How many are really from Asia? He said, 25%. I said, I'm fighting for something. I might need your help. I call it Scott's Law. Now, a lot of Asian students, they come and they study here in Australia and their families pay for them. Actually, they're not always rich families. They save up and they pay for their children to come. And their children are so conscientious that their families have paid for them to come, they don't want to waste their parents' money. So often they could have six students living in a one-bedroom flat and they're bed hopping, you know, to try and keep the cost down. Currently in Australia, if you have a visa to study at university, you're only allowed to do 10 hours of meaningful work. You know, this is crazy because these students are working more than 10 hours. We are just not paying them the right wages. This is how the 7-Eleven case came about. Now, for me, so for the students, I feel that we should recognize that we need to give them a longer period of time. But I'm selfish, and the real reason I'm doing this is because so often people come to me and say, Christine, I'm just a small business. How do I grow my business in Korea? So I say, you go to the universities and you put a sign up on the notice board where the students go to, and you say, I'm looking for a Korean student to do this, call us. So all you have to do, a postcard in the universities. Because this is what we did with Scott. And we found this, we were launching in Korea, none of us spoke Korean, and we didn't really know anything about Korea, but we had an opportunity. And so we found this young guy, Scott, studying law, and he has taught me about the plight of Asian students here. And if we allowed those students to do more than 10 hours work, 20 hours, not too much, 20 hours, they could make a meaningful contribution to SMEs in Australia and help those SMEs get the skills to grow their businesses in Asia. And so it's a win-win. They get a fair wage, they can contribute, they can teach us the skills, and we get their knowledge and their language, and we don't have to pay consultants, you know, hundreds and thousands of dollars. So I do this for Scott, and I call it Scott's Law, and I'm going to fight for these students because they are an incredible source of inspiration living here in our own country. So anyone who
Thank
wants
to back.
Thank
you for that. Questions from the floor, consultants or others who may want to ask. Question up the back, yes. Where are we? Following a microphone here, we'll just turn up the lights a bit. And if you can stand up when you ask the question, that'd be great. Yes, sir.
Thanks. So my question is, you've been quite inspirational, and so a lot of people potentially might want to work for Blackmores or even be CEO, but unfortunately, you have that job. So the thing is, if that wasn't available, what would you do? What's inspiring that you would think about doing? Or the other way, put it around, is what inspires you when you're thinking about innovation in Blackmores? What other companies are doing things that are innovative that you think you might want to do?
You know, someone called me on the way here and they said, you know, who inspires you? And I knew I was coming to see David. So I said, David Gonski. you know, lots of people, I don't know about you, but you could ask me the question tomorrow, I might say somebody else. Lots of different people inspire you. But I think, I don't know how many of you in this room have had the opportunity to meet Andrew Robb, our ex-minister for trade and investment. He is a truly inspirational leader for me. You know, I remember going to him, you know, China is not all easy, let me tell you. We just, as we get this cash from Marcus, we set this business up 5 years ago, they closed the borders. And Adrian will remember, because he was adding the numbers up at the time, and it really hit our profits, but we carried on. And I went to Andrew Robb and I said, Andrew, he said, just carry on, get on with it. And, you know, people like him inspire me that, and you know, the thing about Andrew Robb also inspires me is that he's been very open about having a mental health issue. Like, how many of us would be brave enough now to stand up in Mental Health Week and say, I have had a mental health issue? Not many of us, even deep in our hearts if we feel we have. Because we don't even often go to the doctor or tell the person lying next to us. But here is a man who, you know, in one of the most biggest respected and public jobs in the world, representing our country, writes a book about having mental health disease. So people like him inspire me, that nothing can stop you. And you know, at Blackmores, we're so noisy with each other. We want to become the authority in the world in natural health. We've got some way to go to get that aspiration. But I think we should have a Blackmores University, you know. I think there are so many different things that we can still do, but we have to take it step by step. Our own people inspire me. Miko, with his medicinal tea and working on that night shift, you know, taking his wife. Refugees inspire me, that journey that they take for the one of a better life. I think, you know, sometimes the best ideas just come from our own people.
Question in the middle of, yeah, just here.
My name is Brennan McChristine. I'm a MBA exec grad 2011. My question is, what do you worry about with your international business? What keeps you awake at night?
I'm often awake at night, as Adrian and Kerry will tell you, because I normally get up about 2:30 and start doing my email. So, do you know, again, I think it's a different day. I could tell you a different thing. Always, you know, checking and balancing. Are we doing the right thing? Is this the right place? What are we going to do about this stock? Have we gone here? You know, Thailand, the king is very ill at the moment. Thailand's one of our biggest markets. The king is in a critical stage. If the king dies, there will be civil unrest. And will my people be safe? I worry about that. You know, if Marcus was here, he would say his number one annoyance with me is work-life balance. And he said, that's not good when we're running a well-being company. But, you know, for all of you who believe in work-life balance, I just want to say to you, if you love what you do, you're worrying about everything, you know, because you're loving it. You know, just like you worry about your children or your wife or whoever. Of course, you know, of course you worry. But, you know, worrying is a funny word, isn't it? It sounds negative.
Do you see work and life as a false dichotomy?
Yes, I think if you're loving what you do, why can't it be part of you? You know, why is it wrong to be thinking of it? I don't think it has to be separate. For some people, it's separate. It doesn't have to be separate. You know, I said to Marcus, it's nonsense, Marcus. You're just on your boat. You're telling me, why are you phoning me up? So,
Mr. Chairman.
I don't know that's a good answer, but...
we're going to go with questions over here. Now, madam, yes, your question. Yes, we just pass the mic along to the lady there.
Hi, Christine. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. I just have a question on infant formula. So as a newcomer into the infant formula market, how do you remain competitive against the big players like A2 Platinum, Bellamy's? Thank you.
I think it's a really good question. As people have asked me, why did you do infant formula? And even internally in our own company, we believe breastfeeding is best. So how come you're doing infant formula? And I will tell you why. Because when my sister had cancer, her pregnancy had fed the tumors. And little Eddie was born, and that's when they found the tumors. And that's when we found out she had cancer afterwards. She never had the option of being able to breastfeed her child because she was sick and her body was full of drugs. And so I came to Blackmores, I said to Marcus, we're going to do pet health, we're going into China, and one day I'm doing an infant formula. And Marcus didn't mind the first two, but the third one he always had a problem with. But then I met Barry Irvin from Bega, and I told him, he is an incredible, you should get him here. Can I tell you, he's one of the most inspirational people I've ever met. He's CEO of Bega. He's fantastic, honestly. His journey is incredible. I sat with him. We went for lunch. I didn't want to meet him. He didn't want to meet me, and we became best friends. And I told him a story of my sister that it was probably a fundamentally changing point in my life, who I was as a person. And I knew when I saw her in the coffin, I had to change my life and who I was and be more responsible. And I said, I want to make an infant formula for her one day, but I want it to be as close as possible to breast milk. I said, I don't want, you know, it needs to be the closest we can possibly formulate to breast milk, because that's what a mother really wants to do. So other brands, they may be organic, or they may be something to have A2 protein, but Blackmores infant formula is the closest to breast milk. We are not here to take on A2 and Bellamy's. They are great companies in their own right. We are here to help mothers like my sister who don't have a choice and want a brand they can trust and it be closest to breast milk. At that moment when their lives are in chaos, they can turn to Blackmores and we can help them.
Thanks for that.
Hi, Christine. George Chung. And congratulations for the success with China. But, you know, it's always a country that's not so easy to do business with. Can you share with us some of your success stories? How do you deal with the Chinese leadership, you know, changes every 10 years? And what are some of the challenges?
There's plenty of challenges with China. A gentleman came up to me tonight, and I'm not sure where he is now, but he saw me speak in April in Shanghai, and the Chinese regulations they just announced a big change the week before, and everybody had said the industry has collapsed. This is it over for all food and health companies. We knew it was going to happen. It was all too good. The barrier, you know, the borders will be closed. And it was interesting because people were putting a one piece of page of A4 through Google Translate and coming out with things, nothing to do with what the regulations said. But fear perpetuates fear. And so before we knew it, we're in this huge storm, which was all self-made by, you know, our whole industry and our own people, you know, Blackmores people, but, you know, everyone around. And so with China, I think what you've got to remember is that you don't really make any decisions, the government does. And when you think you know what's happening next, you don't. And things evolve, so you have to be incredibly resilient, you have to be long-term, and you have to evolve and adapt and change too. And so I think I was taught that lesson many years ago working with Hong Kong Telecom, because it was just as the Chinese took over Hong Kong and took ownership of Hong Kong Telecom, and I'm certainly learning it every day in my current job. But I love China, you know, it's such an incredible opportunity, the people are awesome, and it's just not easy. So I don't want you to think it's easy. It is hard work. There are ups and downs. It does not go like this. But anything that is not hard, I challenge you whether you really appreciate it. You know, it's only those things that you've had to fight for that are really, you really hold precious.
Time for just a couple more questions. So yes, in here, yeah.
Thank you. I'm Hui. I'm from China. I spent the last 30 years in China. I want to first, I want to say thank you because I keep sending vitamins to my family, and my parents and my brothers, they all find it's very helpful for their health. Like my brother is taking the liver detox because they do a lot of drinking with government and it's commercial. So that's really helpful. Yeah. And secondly, because I have been working for the Chinese government and commercial world, I think the biggest risk I see for Blackmores is because Blackmores is a foreign company for China. So Chinese government are very sensitive when you grow enough big, like what they are doing for Uber and what doing for Google. So do you see any potential risk in the long term? Thank you.
I think, you know, I think that's a really good question. And sometimes people say to me, how big can you be in China? Our category in China is $50 billion. We might have done $300 million last year. $50 billion, growing more than 10% a year. So you just get your head around $50 billion. I just, you know, I just want 5%.
Last question, we're out of time, but last question here in the front.
Hi, Christine. My name's Lali Waratunga. Thanks for joining us. A fellow Brit, and actually, for my sins, an ex-consultant, actually, at Energis.
I do like
many moons ago. So I actually was a consultant at my time in Accenture with Energis. I now work at Westpac. I'm a customer of Blackmores. My wife and I have had three children, so Blackmores Gold was a stable in our family. My question is this. With such a broad product range, and obviously you're entering new markets, can you talk us through the decision-making process you go through when considering what products not to continue with or to grandfather to archive, for want of a better term?
You know, that is probably one of the hardest things at Blackmores, because we go through this mass debate all the time. No, you can't go with that one. You can't. We have probably 1,000 SKUs, okay? But you've got to remember that we have very different businesses as well. We have a practitioner business. We have a pet health business. We have a Chinese herbal medicine business. That's got 100 SKUs. And we have Blackmores. And then you have, for most of our Asian markets, we're actually in 17 countries now. Soon, we just announced 2 weeks ago, they're going into Iran. And we go through the registration process in September. We announced, we just launched actually in Indonesia. We'll have 12 products there by probably next week actually, and then 30 products by the end of January. Most of our markets we have to go into, we have to formulate for that particular market, for regs, for government or anything else, so it's very complex. But actually we've dealt with that for all 84 years of our history. And I can probably say for 84 years of the history of the company, they've been arguing about which products we delete. The first threshold is, does Marcus use the product? That's the truth. And then the second threshold is, is, you know, sometimes you do have to be careful because you get like multiple pack sizes and things like that. So there's an opportunity to rationalize. But the most important thing is actually understanding what the consumers use that product for and with what other products. So sometimes it's not like, I remember when I was first there, I got there five, you know, they had about 500 then in the main core business. I said, right, let's get rid of 200 and let's just have 300. But then as I spent my first few weeks going out and talking to people, taking the products, I realized that actually some of those small products were the things, the reason why they bought the brand. Not just, if you don't have those small niche products that help them with their particular health issue, they're not going to buy your fish oil. So it's not so straightforward, but it's a huge point of debate. I can't say we've nailed it. I mean, if anyone from Blackmores, and there's a few of us here, think we have, speak up, but we haven't, have we?
Christine, the clock has beaten us. But can I say from my perspective, 13 years of Meet the CEO, probably the most memorable hour that I've seen in all my events here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think we've all learned a lot and we're going to remember what we've learned. But to propose the vote of thanks, delighted that our friend Marina Goh is here. Marina is known as a journalist, a publisher, an author. She's the chair of West Tigers, but a great friend of the University of New South Wales Business School on the Alumni Council. Marina, come and offer a vote of thanks to Christine.
Thank you, Mark. So we're in different codes.
No, I love NRL.
Oh, good.
And cricket.
And
although
cricket,
it's a bad
okay.
word with South Africa, yeah, I so think, this week.
It quickly became a sporting discussion. I'm really honoured to be delivering the vote of thanks on behalf of the alumni. I'm very proud of my business school. I did do my MBA here, and we put on such a fantastic series. I've been to a number of these, and this honestly is one of the most engaging, and primarily because, Christine, you know, I mean, everybody knows you're a fantastic leader. You've won a number of awards. You know, everyone is quite impressed with your career. But to hear you speak about your customers and your staff the way you do is the reason that you're so successful. You know, it's just extraordinary. I'd love to work for you. Everyone here would love to work for you. You're not only inspiring to women, because you're a fantastic female leader, but to all aspiring leaders. And I think that's the reason why this room tonight was, I think, oversubscribed. Apparently, we had too many people in, and everyone was praying that not everyone would turn up because... And that's because of you. So didn't let us down. And to our very own Michael Parkinson, I've seen Mark do this on many occasions. I've worked with Mark in the past. I mean, Mark's an incredible leader as well. And you always, always entertain with your interviewing skills. So thank you very much, Mark. Very, very impressed. And also, David just said to mention too that you don't need your own university. We don't need a Blackmores University because actually we'd be happy to have a Blackmores school at this university. I had to get in early. Yeah. So we've learnt a couple of things, so I won't take up too much of your time, but we learnt a couple of amazing things about Christine tonight, and that you're a fantastic risk taker who backs yourself, and I think that's a lesson for all leaders. But of course, having people who believe in you has been the reason that you've been able to do that. So not only your chairman, who sounds like an incredible man, but great mentors like David, and I'm also fortunate that I've had the benefit of David's mentorship and leadership. And you know, we all need to have people in our lives who believe in us. But I love your positivity and the way that you've turned difficult challenges into a positive. And the stories that you told us tonight will be the stories that we go on then to share with our peers. And clearly that's the reason why you've been successful. So thank you very much. Oh, and also we learnt that bondholders are bastards. Of course, I've written that down as well.
Sorry.
Now, I also have to remind you that we'll be holding our final Meet the CEO event for the year in Melbourne with Shane Elliott, CEO of ANZ, on the 8th of November, another extraordinarily inspirational man. This event will be live streamed for your benefit here in Sydney. However, if you're able to join us from interstate, please do register via the Meet the CEO page on the business school's website. So thank you, Christine, again. Thank you, Mark. And thank you to everyone for attending, and good night. Thanks.